My name is John Pennington, and on behalf of Trust Democracy, welcome everybody to Democracy After COVID. Before I hand over to Professor Lyn Carson, I'll give you a rundown on how tonight will go. We'll be alternating between small groups and plenary. Each small group will be randomly selected, sort of modelling lotocratic styles of deliberation and decision-making. So, quick word on the title, Democracy After COVID. Of course, in a literal sense, we aren't through it yet and probably never will be. It's likely it'll be a constant companion, not to mention other possibilities of other pandemics. But after, in this case, also means following on from or because of. And in the struggle to confront COVID, we've witnessed unprecedented responses from some of our most influential institutions, who in the past have not always been noted for their ideological flexibility. These include central banks, treasuries, and governments. Pretty much throwing at the neoliberal playbook, they did things virtually unthinkable as long ago as yesterday. In the non-aftermath of COVID-19, can democratic politics undergo a similar seismic shift? Tonight, we dig into that possibility. To anyone vaguely familiar with deliberative democracy, Professor Lyn Carson really needs no introduction. She is one of the leaders in the field of democracy and particularly deliberative democracy. Lyn Carson, who prefers Carson, point noted, is currently the research director for the New Democracy Foundation. Carson was formerly a professor in applied politics at the University of Sydney Business School and is a former professor with the University of Western Sydney. She is currently an associate of the Centre for Deliberative Democracy and Global Governance at the University of Canberra. Carson has written extensively on deliberative democracy and has been actively involved in organising many on-the-ground deliberative events, and we're very, very fortunate to have her. So if I haven't forgotten anything in terms of the process, then I'll hand over to you, Carson.
Okay, thanks, John. Great to be here, and it's really nice that I know some of the people in the group. So I'm very aware that there is an enormous amount of knowledge and experience amongst you all. And we thought we would start with introductions, but we knew that was impossible given how many of us there are. So we're just going to put you into small groups before I even begin and just exchange a few words about who you are, but also why you're interested in this particular topic, you know, what brings you here to forfeit some of your evening to spend time amongst us. And we'll just take a few minutes to do this. Andrew is he's Mr. Music or whatever the equivalent is on Zoom, and he's going to put you into small groups. So we'll just take a few minutes to do that, and then we'll come back and I'll talk a little about the history of democracy, and we'll have some more chat, and then I'll talk much more about deliberative democracy, which is why we're here really tonight. Let's begin. So we're going to have a few sessions, if you like, and this first one is about the history of democracy. And as I say, some of you know a great deal about this, so forgive me if I'm speaking down to you in any way. But we thought we just kind of follow. David Runciman has a really nice way of talking about the history of democracy. He talks about the long story, the medium story, and the short story. And I actually think it's a neat way of thinking about where we've come from and where we are now. So if we think of the long story as being the 2,500 years ago in that extraordinary cradle of democracy, Athenian democracy, which was so far ahead of its time, even though it wasn't particularly sympathetic to women and slaves and foreigners, it was actually doing some pretty remarkable stuff. And for me, particularly around the democratic lottery, the fact that people had opportunities to govern and to be governed in turn. And so that's the long story, 2,500 years ago. The medium story is about 250 years ago, and we usually think about that as being the American, the English, and the French revolutions. And the reason that is significant is that there was this abhorrence of monarchies and an overthrow of that form of rule. But unfortunately, they looked towards the Roman model rather than the Athenian model, the Roman Republican model, for very good reasons, that they it was an opportunity to instate elite rule. So political elites took over from monarchies, really, and we lost that sense of the demos of people ruling themselves. 250 years ago, Republican model, not the Athenian model. And in fact, there's evidence of this in things like the Federalist Papers and so on, that there was a conscious decision to give power to the landed gentry. So that's the medium story. The shorter story is what has happened in the last 250 years. And it's definitely a story of increasing enfranchisement. So we went from the landed gentry to giving the vote to all men, to slaves, to women. Some of that happened, the women, quite recently and surprisingly in places like Switzerland, very recently. But we've also improved a whole lot of mechanisms, you could say, around voting systems, you know, preferential voting systems rather than first past the post, though that is extant in places like Canada. I mean, we still have a lot of unfair voting systems throughout the world. We've got this mix of compulsory voting, as we have in Australia, or voluntary voting, which the latter leads to very small proportions of the population actually casting a ballot. We've seen changes in the age that we give to young people. Their right to vote has shifted in some countries down to 16 years of age, some 18, others 21. So that has varied. And I think maybe a much more significant shift has been the rise of political parties, particularly for Australia, the two-party system. You've been, I think, fortunate in New Zealand with MMP, and I'm sure you know the history of MMP and the way in which that came about as a result of almost an accident under David Lange, which is a whole other story that we could talk about. But you have ended up with more diversity in your parliament as a result of that particular voting system. There's almost no country that has no political parties. I think Nauru has no political parties, but I'm not sure that we could look to that as being, you know, the shining light for democracy. But from my point of view, that has become a real weakness in representative government, in that the parties have such an emphasis on elections, on electioneering, that decision-making has become focused on short-termism rather than the long-term. We know that this is true in relation to things like climate change or almost anything which interrogates the possibility of corruption. There's quite a bit happening in Australia trying to create a federal commission against corruption. So political parties maybe are not serving us well, and our constitutions are probably not serving us well because of their anachronistic nature. So we do have this problem of short-termism, and politics is almost a spectator sport. I don't know about New Zealand, but I see it every day in Australia. And we keep thinking if we just change the people who are there, then we'd sort everything out. And actually, that's probably not what's going to help us. So I'm very interested in systemic change. So my own journey towards this, so just in terms of a personal history, is that I was an activist in the 70s, the 80s, and the 90s, and I was probably a very frustrated activist trying to affect change and coming up against this problem that I saw in a political system. And I was accidentally elected, I know that's very hard to believe, to local government in 1991 because I was supporting someone else to be elected. And whoops, I don't know how that happened, but I ended up being elected. And I figured I was so unbelievably miserable that I would do a PhD at the time and just double my misery level. And I started interrogating the system that I was part of in local government in Australia. And I would have to say that if I was to design the world's worst decision-making system, I would probably design local government in Australia. So my PhD was about how elected representatives responded to their communities. And the short answer is not very well. But once I was elected, I became fascinated by power and the way that it functions in political systems. And for me, so much power resides in the decision-making process. So that became my obsession. How do you actually make democratic decisions? And it was clear to me that I wasn't living in a democracy, even though we kept using that term, and it's a fairly recent use of that term, by the way, that we were living in a representative government, but it was looking more like an oligarchy to me than a democracy. So how could you actually create a decision-making space in which it was democratic? And I could see that it was happening amongst our supporters. We were community independents, and we were at a very small scale trying to create that democratic decision-making. So I started experimenting with things which I'll come back to in the next session, and that took me on that road to deliberative democracy. But before I get there, so I'm talking at this stage about 1991, and I'll leave the next 30 years to when we come back again, because we thought it might be good for you to again go into small groups and think about what are the values that are for us just non-negotiable when it comes to a democracy. And maybe think about democracy as more than a political system. Think about it as, you know, a sporting club or a religious group or, you know, I don't care, a university. I could tell you some interesting stories about how we tried to make that democratic in a university context. But what are the values that are non-negotiable in a democracy? And maybe a sub-question, or maybe it's an overarching question, is what's the aim of a democracy? Why do we even think it's a good idea? Like, what is it we're trying to achieve with a democracy? And we'll come back and talk about that after you've had an opportunity to have a bit of a chat amongst yourselves. So again, I hope this isn't too short, but I think we've allocated 10 minutes to this. It's a bit longer than that first time that you had. So off you go, and we'll come back and keep this conversation going. So in this session, I really wanted to start delving into deliberative democracy and maybe even some ways of reframing all sorts of things. But I wanted to start by just saying that just in terms of democratic values for me, that I do consider that the aim of democracy is social cohesion, I have to say. And for that reason, I do really like the Athenian model of being ruled and ruling in turn. So it's finding ways that would enable that kind of turn-taking to happen. And the democratic lottery or sortition or random selection is an ideal way, I think, of enabling that to occur. But because I think the aim is social cohesion, then clearly, we have to think about opportunities for collaboration to try to distance ourselves from any kind of fruitless debate or the grandstanding and so on. And that's starting to happen worldwide. It's sometimes called the deliberative turn, or the OECD more recently has called it the deliberative ways. And it's a movement, I guess, that is happening throughout the world. But it happened for me in the 1990s when I started experimenting with citizens' juries in Lismore, which is in northern New South Wales. And the way that I was working was to have them mesh with council activities. So I was randomly selecting people using a lottery based on where they lived, bringing them together, having them think about planning in local government, and then feeding that through to the council. And there are principles inherent in citizens' juries that exist in all of the methods that you will encounter if you start looking at deliberative experiments. So they take many forms: consensus conferences, citizens' assemblies, deliberative polls, citizens' juries. There's an initiative convention in the US, citizen initiative review in the US. They all have similar elements. And the elements are that they are inclusive, they're very representative of the entire population, and you achieve that through that democratic lottery process. We can talk a whole lot more about that. They're deliberative, which is why it's called deliberative democracy, and that means that they need a lot of time and a lot of information to actually digest the, you know, very complex issues, and then they have to explore common ground. They don't have to reach consensus. They try to move towards consensus. Minority views are always honoured. And they need to have some influence. They need to have some impact. And that's become very important for us in New Democracy. And the reason it's become important for us is that our first experiment was with the Australian Citizens Parliament, where we randomly selected 150 people, one from every electorate throughout Australia. We brought them together to discuss how to strengthen Australia's democracy. And over many days, we had regional meetings preceding that, online work. I think it was a highly successful project. It culminated in a lot of research and an edited book, but it had no influence. We didn't have the imprimatur of government. And ever since, all of the work that a New Democracy has done has been based on almost a contractual arrangement with the government to say, we want to guarantee that you will actually take on board these recommendations, that you will publicly state why or why not you have accepted them. So influence becomes a really important component of that. Now, does it pass the sniff test, as John is using that phrase? I'm interested for you to note any objections you might have to that. I used to, when I was working with students at a university, I'd say, I want you to write yes, but notes. You know, yeah, it's all very well and good, but. And so I'm very interested in your yes, but claims about deliberative democracy, because not everyone sees this in the way that we do at New Democracy, although it is definitely gathering favour, you might say. The most significant experiments have been in Ireland, so we could talk about that as an example, where you'd be aware that they were the first country to legalise same-sex marriage, and that came about through a deliberative process. So there was a citizens' assembly. It culminated in recommendations about issues that should go to a referendum, and it ended up, that was one of the issues. They've looked at a number of other things like abortion, very contentious issue in Ireland, and that went to a referendum and was passed. So it's often referred to because it kind of, you know, it exemplifies best practice in terms of being able to do a deliberative process that has the imprimatur of government and is then taken out to the entire population to cast a vote. It may not be that a referendum is the best way of resolving that, taking it out to the whole population. The British Columbian Citizens Assembly demonstrated how that can come unstuck. They had a Citizens Assembly on electoral reform, and having that group decided, 170 people, that they should change the electoral system. It went to a referendum, and at the time of the referendum, the two parties did what two parties do. The opposition came in attacking what the Citizens Assembly had done, and it didn't pass the 60% mark that it had to in order to change the electoral process in Canada, which is, well, it was British Columbia, which is most unfortunate because they have an unfair system. So we could talk some more about how you take that out to the wider population. There are certainly some interesting mechanisms that we've employed in terms of a huge project like the one we did in South Australia on nuclear waste disposal, where we had kitchen table conversations throughout the whole state. Thousands of people were involved online and in small groups, public meetings, shopping centres. It started with a citizens' jury of 50 people who set the agenda based on a Royal Commission report. It culminated in a huge assembly of 300 plus people. They made a recommendation that nuclear waste disposal should not happen in South Australia. That went against where the government was going, and the government, to its credit, honoured the recommendations of those people, of its population, of its citizenry, and it has not proceeded. The Premier at the time, Jay Weatherill, is now on the research committee of New Democracy. So I'm pleased to say he's a real deliberative Democrat as a result of that experience. So, yes, but I'm not sure whether we were going to go, I don't think we were going to go back into small groups for this. I think at this stage, what we'd really like is for you to post comments or questions or whatever in the chat box. You know, if you want an opportunity to actually say something, then we can do that as well, to ask questions, to make a comment. There's a few people present at the moment who've had experience with this, not the least of is John and Simon, who did one of the very early experiments with citizens' juries in New Zealand, and which is how I came to know them. I think another thing that we might think about is a way of redefining, reframing some things that we just accept as the way it is done. And I think leadership is one of these things. For a start, we think we have to have individual leaders. You know, we have to have an individual prime minister, and anyone who can name the Prime Minister of Switzerland for me gets a gold star, because I'm pretty sure none of you will be able to, because they ain't got one. You know, they have an executive and they rotate that ceremonial role, but there's no real power residing in that Prime Minister. So why we think we need leadership residing in a single person, I don't know. For me, leadership that is based on a process designer, you know, someone, a leader who actually develops a democratic process that will strengthen decision-making sounds like a good idea to me. Someone who can inspire sounds like a good idea to me. Someone who can encourage us to exercise our best instincts and not our worst instincts, which is kind of where we seem to go with political parties. And I think if we're going to think about political parties, we should also think about, I don't know what it's like in New Zealand, but in Australia, you know, we have a capital O for opposition. So they are the opposition from day one, and their job is to be adversarial, to be, you know, a thorn in the side, to just argue against anything, even if they agree with it. And mostly their policies seem pretty similar to me, but heck, we just have to disagree with each other. So could we get rid of political parties? Could we say that their respective, their various ideologies become NGOs? You know, you have an NGO for the free market, an NGO for small government. I don't know. Can we think creatively about this? And just in terms of that reframing, I throw that idea in just because of what John said at the start, you know, that COVID enabled us to just think wildly and creatively about a whole bunch of things that were just off the table always, and suddenly they were possible. So if we're in an environment in which anything is possible, what might be possible? So it's kind of over to you at this point, but I'm really happy to hear what you have to say or to clarify anything. I've done a bit of a sweeping, you know, deliberative democracy, hardly even 101. What more can I tell you, or what more would you like to say? So someone's saying that they'd like to explore, you know, best practice and best method and what the principles might be. There's a whole lot of discussion in deliberative circles about how you can ensure best practice. And one of the things that we've been very proud of is that the OECD has recently published best practice principles for deliberative work, and they're pretty much modelled on the principles that New Democracy has used over the years. They're an elaboration of the sorts of things that I talked about before in terms of representativeness, deliberation and influence and so on, but they include other things like transparency and, you know, they're really trying to reinforce the notion of the robustness of the method. So it's all in the design choices. Now, this becomes incredibly important when you look at things like the, I'm sure you've tuned into a lot of the activism around citizens' assemblies and climate change. Like, here's a way of resolving climate change. We just need to have more and more citizens' assemblies. And a lot of those assemblies are being convened by activists who have a particular agenda running. They could almost tell you what the recommendations are from that assembly before the assembly actually meets, which rather discredits the process. So I guess we're all trying to ensure that there are some real principles that are being followed here so that we can actually look to something like a citizens' assembly and say it's been evaluated well, the random process has been robust. So those design choices have become really important for all of us to ensure that they are robust, that they can be defended, that everything is transparent. New Democracy puts everything on our website, you know, the design of the jury that we might be undertaking, how we did the selection, how long they're going to talk for, who the experts are. People should always have an opportunity that have been randomly selected to choose their own experts. We might be able to provide baseline information, but we absolutely want them to be able to call experts of their choice. They need a lot of time to talk together, a lot of small group discussion, which is why we were doing a bit of small group work here. So I'm not sure that I fully answered that, but that's kind of how we're trying to ensure that there is integrity in the processes.
So Lyn, there's I don't know if this is a fair question for you, but there's a question about individual representation, so individuals representing themselves and collective representation because of the treaty situation in New Zealand.
Mm-hmm.
So collective entities versus individuals. Do you have any comments about that?
Yes. I think it's, you know, I'm not familiar with the New Zealand situation except what you've told me, Simon, about the treaty, and I can understand its contentiousness. But it's really important for us that when people come into a deliberative space, that they come in as individuals, not being delegates of an organisation, because you tend to end up replicating the very problem that you see in a parliamentary situation where it's not what the individual MP thinks, it's what the party thinks. And we don't want people coming into a deliberative space representing a particular NGO or whatever. We find that what happens is, even if it had happened with the nuclear project, that there were definitely people who were randomly selected who belonged to NGOs, you know, environmental NGOs or whatever. And people usually find it fairly easy to start letting go of that if there is a real emphasis on, but what do you think? You know, we're interested in this as a microcosm of the whole population. That's usually what we're trying to do. There's no reason why you can't, when you've got a collective interest like that. I mean, the only thing I can think of that's vaguely similar in Australia is the Indigenous voice that has happened recently. And that was done amongst entirely Indigenous people. And it was actually a very good deliberative process. So they did regional meetings. They didn't use random selection, but they found other mechanisms for getting additional voices in the room, because the dilemma is that if you keep getting, in Indigenous terms, Indigenous elders to speak, well, we kind of know what they're going to say. You know, we're trying to, through deliberative work, hear voices that would otherwise not have a voice. So we're trying to hear from the entire population, a microcosm of the entire population, and not from people who typically have a seat at the decision-making table. But you can bring that collective voice in other ways through expert speakers, of course. You know, there's no reason on earth why you can't, as we have had with the nuclear project, Indigenous speakers came in talking about the Indigenous experience of nuclear, you know, atomic explosions in South Australia. And it had a tremendous impact on that randomly selected group who, you know, were deeply affected by what they heard from the Indigenous speakers. So again, it's all about design choices and ensuring that all voices are heard, all perspectives are heard. You want everyone to wheelbarrows in the room. You know, you don't want to exclude any opinion, any viewpoint.
So we've got quite a few questions about representation, Carson. So including self-appointed or elected people in assemblies, and well,
let me take that one first, and we can come to
and what other representing non-humans such as
possums
or something.
Yeah, we do often have there's a lot of young people doing this, by the way. So there are youth parliaments and youth juries. I've convened a few youth juries. So there are often younger voices that are just never heard. So that's one way we can bring the next generation into the space. We often have an empty chair for a future generation because we don't know what's going to happen, but it just is a reminder that, well, what's going to happen? You know, when we're all dead and gone, what does it mean for that? So there's been a beautiful project in Japan where they actually dressed up in these robes and represented, you know, people in 100 years time, or yeah, there's been some really lovely, they're just, again, design choices, very creative. MPs is interesting. There's a research note on our website that I've written about involving elected representatives with the randomly selected group, and Ireland has done both on different occasions, but it does have one that we can point to where they had a third politicians and two-thirds randomly selected people. I would favour less, maybe, you know, 25% elected reps. And I would probably just favour them at the beginning of a process and the end of the process so that they have some ownership of it. But there's such a tremendous power imbalance that it's important to enable people to speak frankly about whatever they want to say without feeling intimidated by those who they may consider have a greater right to speak. There's been a lovely project in France that was organised by a media company that brought people together, and they brought people together in a cafe, and I think Nicholas told me about this, and he's on this call, where the MPs sat around small tables talking to randomly selected people about policy. So again, it's a bit of a design choice, isn't it? There's any number of ways that you can ensure that that happens. It kind of depends on the issue and why you would want to include any of the people or futures that you talked about. Future search is another method that you can use that has much more of a focus on future generations.
So there's quite a bit of support for Max Rashbrook's question, which I'll read out to you.
Okay.
One question I have concerns the role of power imbalances and justice. When I talk about deliberative democracy, people sometimes say, why should those losing out, e.g. young people who can't buy homes, have to sit down and talk with those doing well, e.g. older homeowners? Why shouldn't they just try and get their desires implemented by a majority government, given the rights justice argument behind them?
Well, a majority government's not going to take care of them, as we've seen. You know, that's the problem. That's why we're experimenting with deliberative methods, because their voices are just not being heard. But we can definitely rectify that by having a youth assembly on an issue like that on housing. In fact, I've just written a chapter on this very thing, because housing has homelessness is very interesting, not just and housing is interesting increasingly because of different cohorts, like single older women are having real problems finding housing in Australia, as well as young people who will probably never own a home the way things are going. So there's different cohorts that are affected. But you could actually have a design choice that had a youth assembly and had those who already own homes. You know, one of the demographics that we also often choose when we're looking at something like housing, and we've done one of these, is to ensure that we select in terms of home ownership and those who are renting, so that we can ensure that we've got the voices of those who don't own or don't have a possibility for owning. So it's merely a design choice. In order, we're back to the, we want all of the issues on the table and everyone to be heard. And if we think that there is a power imbalance and young people would not be heard well, then we would do well to have a youth assembly to look at that. And there've been some fabulous youth assemblies that have been convened in Australia and elsewhere, some brilliant stuff happening in Africa at the moment with youth cafes. So I'm all for handing over that responsibility to the generation who's going to be most impacted by whatever the decision is that's being discussed.
Here's a question, Carsten, I think that, is a really pertinent question. And I think hopefully I've got this right. So the models we've discussed so far look like they leave out quite a few voices, and we're just replacing one form of representative democracy with another. And I think maybe this question gets to, well, look, you in any one time or even multiple times, you only have small numbers of people, even if you have something like a citizens assembly, or, you know, which may have 100 or 150 people. But I mean, across the population, even the size of New Zealand, that's infinitesimal. Yeah. So really, you've just got more small groups or another small group making decisions for the larger population.
Thanks, John. Yeah, well, it isn't the same. You're not replicating the problems of a parliament because they're one-off. So you meet together for a period of days and then it's disbanded. So it isn't entrenched in the same way that it is in a parliamentary environment. And there are also ways in which you can expand it. There was a model that we helped to create in Madrid, for example, that was open to the entire population. So people went online suggesting policy directions, and then there was an assembly that made decisions about which policy direction to deliberate on. And then you can send it back out to that wider population to review or to evaluate. So we are in an environment now, much better than it was in Athens, it was just a city state, where we can actually go out to an entire population for input. So increasingly there's people thinking about different methods where you have an agenda setting group that could be an entire population, as it was in Madrid. You can have the deliberative group that is doing the deeper work. In Austria, they've got a very nice model where they then take it out to cafes and they meet with hundreds of people to have those hundreds of people comment on the decisions of the smaller group. So you can keep snowballing this out, depending again on what the issue is. It's just a design choice. We involve thousands in that process in South Australia, and I don't know of any parliamentary experiment that has meaningfully involved thousands of people other than the empty ritual of the vote, where we get a chance to put a cross in a square and we didn't even have any say in the pre-selection process. So it's certainly not replicating the inequalities or the powerlessness that I think is inherent in the current electoral system. Right. And in fact, one of the great things about these processes is that people are very empowered by it, you know, and they talk to their wider community. I've been doing quite a bit of work on critical thinking and on unconscious biases, and we always start our processes. Imagine if we did this in parliaments, where we do exercises in critical thinking. So we're actually encouraging critical thinking amongst people who may not have had a university education and be unfamiliar with those ways of thinking, and a recognition of their own biases, but also the biases of the expert speakers who come into the room. And I can tell you, there is nothing more heartening than finishing one of these events and having people say, I will never watch the news in the same way again. You know, that we've created a school for critical thinking and democratic experience that we hope will be taken back to schools, universities, sporting groups, unions. I don't know. I mean, it's endless potential to use methods like this to create some genuine democracy.
Fantastic. Thank you. I guess that, you know, the simple point is that it's open. It's open to everybody. I mean, your chances are, you know, it doesn't matter who you are.
Everyone should have an equal chance of selection. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I suppose we haven't talked about it, but we base it on demographics. So one example was the Australian Citizens Parliament. We sent out 8,000 invitations and we got 2,500 back, people who were prepared to go to regional meetings and come for 4 days in Canberra. So we had a 35% response rate, which is unheard of, by the way. It's amazing. But we were selecting allocating to different, different piles. So we've got the demographics of the entire population in terms of age, sex, education levels, location, and so on. So we're trying to end up with a group of people who look like the population. You should be able to walk into the room and say, yep, this looks like Australia, this looks like New Zealand, this looks like Wellington. You know, however diverse your population is, it should look like that in the room. Now, let us compare that with a parliament. And I don't know what it's like in New Zealand, but I can tell you, if you go into an Australian parliament, it does not look like the Australian population.
So we've got a couple of questions, Carson, about how the pandemic response has been dealt with through top-down authoritarian crisis management, so not particularly democratic. So,
yeah,
and then how might that be different when it's no longer the crisis, but we're facing an endemic, situation?
I think it's a great question. We had a situation in Australia where the states and the federal government came together and they worked collaboratively, and we were all so excited to think, oh, they've set aside their party allegiances and they can actually work for our benefit. And it was very short lasting. They were at each other's throats and the Libs were against the Labor and so on, which is very depressing. Meanwhile, we've been doing a project for the United Nations Democracy Fund. And we did a project in North Macedonia, and that was actually the topic, COVID and vaccination. They had very poor vaccination rates in North Macedonia, and the people were randomly selected. They came together online because of the pandemic and made recommendations about different mechanisms that should be put in place to encourage people to be vaccinated, or assuming that that's what they thought was an appropriate thing to do. They were kind of deliberating on how do we deal with this, in ways that we could do on absolutely any topic, and we can do it very quickly. It's not as though this has to, particularly if you're doing any kind of online work, this isn't something that needs to take years of planning, and it doesn't require elections and parliaments and so on. We can even have standing panels, which we've done in my area. I'm in Bundjalung, on Bundjalung land in Byron Bay in northern New South Wales. And this council has created a standing panel. So it's got a randomly selected group, and it can just bring them together on different topics at different times on different issues. So it's actually very easy to quickly assemble a group of people to assist in any kind of policy making or political decision making. I hope that answers it.
What do you do? There's a question here about really requiring people to be non-partisan, independent, disinterested, supposedly as our betters in Parliament or wherever are. So are those necessary qualities, are they even achievable? And if, what kind of response is that?
It's a really good question, because there is something, I wish I had a better answer. There's almost like a magic that happens. People come into a space amongst strangers, and they will come in using singular personal pronoun, sort of I this, I that, my backyard, this is all I know, my experience. And before long, there is some kind of weird shift that is an identification with this group of people. And they will start to say, well, we have a responsibility to think on behalf of the whole community. I mean, they are being reminded about that, that you are here to offer your personal experience and your personal perspective. Remember, the decisions that you make are on behalf of everyone. So let me give you an example. We did a citizens' jury on container deposit legislation, and we needed to have expert speakers from the packaging industry and the industry groups, basically, as well as environmental groups, because it was an environmental issue. And at the 11th hour, and there's a whole backstory to this, but 11 p.m. the night before, the industry groups pulled out and said, we're not going to participate in this. And we presume it's because they kind of knew how it might end up. I don't know. And we therefore had to say to the environment groups, well, we can't have you here either, because it's just going to be, there's going to be this weird imbalance, you know, if you speak and they don't. So we created a library of resources, and we had an independent researcher lead people to, you know, what do you want to know about that? Well, here, go to this document and so on. So they kind of had to do their own research and find out their own stuff. But what fascinated us about this was that they began asking, what are going to be the consequences for the packaging industry? What's the consequences for the, you know, soft drink industry or whatever? And then they started saying, we don't have a pensioner in the room, you know, like someone who lives on old age pension. What are the consequences for them? So they start asking questions about, you know, it goes back to that future generation stuff as well. They will start asking questions about people who are very unlike them. And they actually made recommendations that took into account, you know, the environment and industry and so on in a very sensible and measured way. There's something about the collective that I think enables people to let go of their real, you know, adherence to sometimes a particular ideology, but not so much that. You're not trying to get them in the room to change their minds. You just want people in the room who can explore their common ground together. And I think the reason that I find that so effective is that when I was elected, it used to drive me crazy that I think 90% of the time we could agree on 90% of this stuff. Why do we spend so much time arguing about the 10% that we disagree on? You know, we would spend hours arguing about petty cash, and we would pass $1 million budget, you know, in minutes. It just didn't make any sense to me. Well, that does not happen in a deliberative space. They will, as we've seen with, you know, a $4 billion participatory budget in Melbourne, they will interrogate the, you know, the whole spreadsheet. They will want answers to everything. And it's not just about their own needs, their own views. It's about the entire community. Does that answer, John?
Yeah, that's well. It answers it for me, and hopefully for the person who asked it. What about the role of the media in developing a deliberative democratic culture? What are your thoughts on that? And is there anything going on in Australia? How is it happening there?
It's not easy. In fact, I think it might be one of the biggest challenges. So we tend to work with the Australian Citizens Parliament. We worked with local media outlets, and I think quite effectively. So they interviewed people who were randomly selected if those people wanted to be interviewed, and they were very sympathetic to that project. So it requires a lot of work, you know, a real communication strategy. It's one of the things mentioned in the OECD principles. But we spend a lot of time at New Democracy getting media on side, left, right, we don't care, you know, just really explaining to them what the process is going to be so that we get some kind of fair summary of what's going on. But one of the things that you'll find is that because of the way in which media likes to write dramatic stories, I could point to a fantastic example in West Australia where they've, you know, the right-wing media came out in opposition to a citizens' jury that happened, or it was a big assembly actually that happened there. And the most fantastic thing was that all the people who had been randomly selected got angry. So the letters to the editor were actually from people who had been part of the process, defending the process. And that's actually what you want. And in a way, it's what elected representatives want. They want to be able to stand in front of a decision, you know, and say, well, this is what they decided, and to have representatives from that group saying, yes, it's what we decided. We had a great process. Bearing in mind, this can be a bit of a rescue mission for elected representatives who seem disinclined to make hard decisions if it's, they're in a bit of a pickle. So at least one MP in Western Australia used to say, this is when a deliberative method works best, when MPs are just stuck, they can't make the decision. Well, let's share the decision-making with the wider community, in which case it's pretty hard then for the media to come down hard on it. But it's tricky, you know. Social media is tricky. Mainstream media is tricky. It's something that we just have to spend a lot of time working with. But there have been some really lovely, you know, television programs and so on that have been done on this sort of activity. It can be a bit boring, so it doesn't lend itself to a reality show, but you can get some very good media coverage.
There's a question from Eddie about your experience of trying to shift organizations, maybe a council, from really rudimentary engagement, which is basically informing and consulting, through to you know, collaboration and deliberation. Have you got any thoughts about how to
facilitate
that shift?
We wouldn't go to a council that had no interest in this. It's usually people come to us and say, it's usually the mayor or the general manager, or maybe it's the community engagement people, and they know that there is at least some appetite for deliberative methods. And we will then go in and do a workshop with the elected representatives. We wouldn't actually do the deliberative method without exposing them to the principles, the practices, the experience, or, you know, the kind of stuff we're talking about here. We wouldn't do it without doing that first. And we've got some fantastic experiences of UPEN for us was a brilliant exercise in Belgium, where we actually took some members of parliament from the New South Wales parliament to Belgium. They did a summer school there, both sides of politics, you know, including the Greens, you know, Liberal, Labour. And they have become our most solid advocates in the New South Wales parliament for work that we're doing there. So I think we overestimate the capacity of an elected representative to actually get this stuff without being exposed to it through some kind of workshop or, you know, a summer school or something, you know, it's hard to wrap your head around the real advantages of this. And, you know, we can point to some fantastic experiences where in New South Wales, we had a mayor who was very keen on this stuff, a Labor mayor. And he did a couple of citizens' juries, and we then had council elections, and every Labor mayor in the state, their vote went down. And his was the only one that went up. So we actually have some empirical evidence that it can actually serve you well. If you do this well, your community sees that you take it seriously, what the community thinks about stuff, enough to convene citizens' juries on very significant topics.
We've got 15 minutes to go, so we haven't sort of addressed the yes, no, but questions.
Yeah.
Are we going to break into small groups?
We could just have people make comments here
I mean,
we're not a huge group. We've got 30 people, so you could just raise your hand if you've got a comment or a yes, but and. Let's hear it. We've got time. Would be great to hear your voices.
Okay, seeing as I've got my mic on, I'll jump in just while people are sort of getting their heads around this. Look, come on. You know, we've just been through a number of major crises over the last, you know, decade, say. Global meltdowns, terrorist activity, COVID. Decisions have got to be made, you know, pronto. We can't be sitting around navel-gazing with them.
How's that going for us? Just in terms of climate change, you know, boy, we're really making some speedy decisions there and really sorting things out. I think actually if you want non-decision-making, let's look to parliaments, because I think it's their raison d'etre. You know, this is how we do stuff here. We delay tricky decision-making as long as we can because we want to get elected in 3 years' time. So we don't want to stick our necks out. So I actually think we do need different decision-making mechanisms and on some of these very tricky issues.
One of the things with climate change is the need for evidence about what's going to reduce emissions and so on. How do you envisage the evidence being collected to empower this decision-making when it's coming from informal, well, not informal really, but informal in the sense it's not part of the public service?
Just unpack that a little for me. Do you mean that the deniers of climate change, that's your concern, or you're trying to ensure that you get balanced information? What's the concern? Just flesh that out a bit for me, would you?
It's not about balanced decision that I'm looking for here. It's that to actually reduce emissions is going to take a lot of work. We're going to have to change the whole way in which people transport themselves. We may have to change our agricultural system. And James Shaw has gone off, our minister for the environment's gone off to GOP with a lot of stuff that is satchel, so to speak, that's been put together for him by the Department of Conservation, the Ministry of the Environment, the Ministry of Transport, and so on. I suspect he's going to come back and be relatively effective in New Zealand to convince us to do some major changes. What if this was someone coming from the community themselves that actually doesn't have the ability to collect that kind of evidence that he does? How do they then? They might come up with a good decision, but how do they empower the decision to actually work and operate?
There's a couple of fantastic examples of this because there have been so many climate assemblies throughout the world, and some of them have been very good. Macron, for example, in France, convened a climate assembly and he guaranteed to act on it in a number of ways, either through legislation or a referendum or so on. And the way that they worked it was to divide the group into various aspects of you, as you've just described, like transport was one of the areas that they looked at. So when you have an assembly, what happens is that you give those people baseline information. It's usually by the person who convened it, government. This usually got a lot of this information. So the emphasis is on factual information that you are giving people. So it's not necessarily this is what we should do or shouldn't do. This is the circumstance. This is where we're at now. That could be these are our options. And those people then have an opportunity to read that information, to have experts come in who they can interrogate about various aspects of that information. They can ask for more information. We usually have, you know, boards all around the room for information gaps. What don't we still know? What do we need to know in order to make this decision? So remember, we're talking about days of deliberation. We're not talking about, you know, a public meeting or whatever. And in, I would argue that the people who come into these processes at the end of 4 or 5 days know more than what a member of parliament would know, who's usually briefed prior to going into a parliamentary assembly. You know, they may have a lot of information given to them, but it's often been digested by someone else and it has to accord with a particular ideology. Whereas the groups in a deliberative process have read it all. They've read it. You usually find that in a large group, you get some people who are just, they know everything. They have read every word of every document you've given them. And they may even be in a position where they start briefing other people in the group who may not have read that particular document they read. Or they start bringing in new information, which they then put to experts in the group. So it's kind of amazing, you know, having done things like a consensus conference on genetically modified organisms in the food chain, it's pretty amazing what people can learn. Now, here's an important thing, though. We are not trying to turn them into scientists. They're usually there because they have to make value judgments about very complex information. So they don't need to be an expert by the time they come out. They certainly need to know enough to be able to form a value judgment on, so what do we do? You know, what option should we go for? What are the weaknesses of that? What are the strengths of that? That's what we're looking for, not do you know how many, well, they probably know things like parts per million, but you know what I'm saying. They don't need to get underneath the, they're not environmental scientists.
Yeah, I think what you've led to then is you've highlighted another stream of questioning that's been going on, which is there's no MP here or local government official here in this group. What have you done to get government officials of one ilk or the other to actually commit to these 4-day deliberative meetings? What do we need to be doing here to get our...
Yeah, I don't know why. It's such an interesting question you've asked, because I'm not sure why it hasn't had the... hasn't developed the momentum or the take-up in New Zealand that I see in other Western countries. As I said, we've done these summer schools, which are very effective for MPs. We spend quite a bit of time lobbying. So our executive director does have MPs on side from, you know, both sides of the fence. So there's a lot of briefing that goes on. Simon has put on the website some resources that I've given to him. And if you look at New Democracy's website and you go under research and R&D notes, there are a series of about 40 or 50 research notes that I have written that are designed for members of parliament. So the instruction that I was given by a former politician was, write me a note on what is deliberation, what is random selection, you know, how do you do this? How do you hear from experts? How do you select experts? And make them short enough so that a member of parliament can read and absorb them and understand it. So we find that whenever there is a query about something, we now have a briefing document that we can immediately offer on that topic. It could be on a case study, you know, like, well, here's how Macron did it in the out of the Prime Minister's office in France, a climate assembly. You know, here's how they did it in Ireland. We often draw on those people, like the MPs in Ireland who were part of that assembly process, and they are such good advocates, you know, to talk to other MPs. And in fact, they were very influential in that summer school that I mentioned. So often we'll have a workshop where we bring in other MPs, because there's nothing quite like that. You know, the kind of impediments that they might see can be overcome, you know, and someone's there to tell them how to overcome it. So I don't know, you've got work to do in New Zealand. I'm relying on you to do that work, Suzanne. So you've asked the question, and please go to it. I know it's possible because I've seen it happen. But I think you should also bear in mind that I've been doing this for 30 years. So it hasn't happened overnight. And there was a definite upturn in about 1999, 2000 in Australia. And I think there's some kind of deliberative turn that happens in different countries at different times. So you may be ready for it. I'm aware that we're kind of getting close to our time, but I'm John and Simon, I'm in your hands.
Well, there's still plenty of time for last drinks. Come on, somebody must have some fairly niggly. Actually, there's a written question here from somebody who's right in the thick of it. And, you know, saying, is there a danger sometimes of being a little bit too pushy about this stuff? You know, in terms of elected representatives, whether at local or central level, you know, you can sort of try and move the lever too fast.
Actually, that's really interesting, because what's happening in Victoria at the moment, we were very instrumental in getting some legislation through at a state government level that local government had to implement deliberative methods. And we're pretty proud of this, you know, like, yay, we've got some legislation through. But, of course, not every council is ready to do that. And a lot of the councils are just trying to tick the box and, you know, what can we get away with? What can we do that merely ticks the box? But we're heartened by that. In fact, I'm about to do a session with some of the local governments that have done a stunning job on deliberative methods. Now, that's probably because there's a consulting group in Victoria, Mosaic Lab, you know some of the people, who've been running workshops for various local governments and have helped them think through design for how to create a deliberative method. It's to develop a community plan and a bunch of other things. And they've had some real successes, but you wouldn't say that every local government in Victoria has followed the legislation to a T. So it may be that what we're going to see is that we're going to see other local governments look towards, oh, so that's best practice. Look what they're doing in so-and-so and such-and-such. It may be, I keep saying, we should have some awards. You know, let's have an award for the most fantastic, you know, robust method and share it around. You know, that I think there are ways that we can begin to talk about it that are not saying to people, you must do this, because there's a fair chance that they won't want to do it and they won't do it particularly well. And we'd much prefer that people did it with enthusiasm because they understood the principles and they actually want to practice those principles. So it is a bit of a fine line, I think, between advocating it, spruiking it, and ensuring that you actually have buy-in and that it's going to be done. It's going to be done well.
Right. I think we're just about there. but I'd like just to ask one final question. You know, I've read people like Helene Lansamore suggesting, you know, outlining a potential democratic governance system with no elected representatives. Are there any examples of at small scale of that happening anywhere that you know of? Do you think it's feasible?
Yeah. Well, we know that it's happening alongside, you know, Belgium being the best example of this, that it happened in one area of Belgium and it will be taken up now by the federal government. And the way that's working is to have a randomly selected group alongside an elected group that are able to convene assemblies a number of times a year, and they are feeding into it. So it's a kind of integrated method. There's a research note on the website about the Belgian model if you want to have a look at that. So that's actually being held up as a fantastic example of how you could integrate it. I absolutely favour a randomly selected House of Parliament and could think of nothing better. I think the chances of it happening are fairly remote, although in Australia, Queensland eliminated its upper house under Joe Bjelke-Petersen. And it could actually have a people's Senate as well as having an elected lower house. There's no reason on earth. It doesn't have to be formal even. They could just have it as an additional layer. There's any number of possibilities, but yeah, I mean, ideally, I'm pretty fond of the Athenian model, and I think we can overcome its deficiencies of no women, no slaves, no foreigners. I would just ask the question, could it be any worse than what we have now? And